your name, man. Shake up your neighbor and says, man, wake up.
Wake up.
It's time to get excited. It's time to get resurrected.
Come on.
It's time to get saved. Rearrange. Take us to elevate us into the realm of heaven. Amen. It's good to be here this morning. If you have your Bibles, I want you to go with me to the book of Isaiah. I'm going to take this opportunity to be able to make a few commercial announcements. Amen. Well, we're excited. Immediately after the service, we don't want you to be in such a rush. We want you to go to stop by, hang out with us. We're going to be having a family potluck. Amen. How many of y'all love food? How many of y'all love people? When you put people and food together, something happens. Amen. It's called transformation. Amen. There's power in numbers. The Bible says, confess your sins to one another. Say what? Confess my who? No, those are mine. No, it says confess. So when you confess, you profess. When you profess, you're able to talk to somebody. You're able to get to know somebody. You're able to really see who they are. Amen. Never judge a book by its cover. Amen. They might look a little weird, but that might person might be your best friend. Come on, somebody. You just never know. And then also, next week, everyone say next week.
Next week.
Next Sunday morning, all day, matter of fact, we're going to be having our United We Can Day. So we want to encourage the whole entire church to come and dress up. I don't want to see nobody in suits. Hello, somebody. Come representing a country, a continent. Amen. We got South America in the house. Amen. We have Africa in the house. We have Europe in the house. We have the United States in the house. You can come as a cowboy. That's all right. Come on, somebody. Just come representing. We have two powerful speakers. In the morning, we're going to have our multi-regional pastor, Tony Garcia. Yeah. Very powerful man of God. He's been with the ministry for a variety of years. Amen. And then that following night, we're going to be having Pastor Rick Alanis Jr. Amen. Yeah. And for all the men in the house here this morning, Saturday at 6 p.m., we're going to be having a men's discipleship. Amen. It's going to be a powerful time right there with Pastor Rick Jr. It's going to be at 6 in the morning. They're going to have their regional passion for purpose. Well, that following night, how many of y'all know that the Lord always saves it for the best, for the men? Come on, man. And we're going to be having a discipleship with Pastor Rick Jr. It's going to be a powerful time. Come for the fellowship. Come to get equipped, trained, developed. Amen. Such a powerful thing that we're able to have the church house open. And we're able to teach and train and develop couples and individuals to get ready to be launched out to the every parts of the world. Amen. Well, what they're carrying is one thing, and that's the gospel of Jesus Christ, the resurrection power. Hello, somebody. And I'm so privileged and honored to be able to come and speak here this morning. If you have your Bibles, I want you to go to the book of Isaiah chapter 6. When you're there, give me a good amen. And I also want to thank the Lord. It's been going on 12 years this October that I gave my life to the Lord. Amen. I came in here hoping with no direction. I came in here a gang member, a drug addict, did 6 years in and out of jail, and the Lord rearranged my life. He hooked me up with a good wife. I'm going to be having a son soon. Hello, somebody. I'm a product of our Christian recovery home. Amen. And you're probably wondering, why are these men out here separate? Why? Because they have a calling. They have a purpose. Amen. And they need to be separated for just a little bit. Amen. So they can get trained and equipped to take them back to society. So no longer they're going to be a problem, but they're going to be a solution. A solution for drug habit. A solution for violence. A solution to get families back together. Am I talking to anybody here this morning? That's what our Christian recovery homes is all about. Amen. We had over a handful of graduates that graduated. Now they got jobs. They're part of the D home. Amen. They're being productive. They're doing something in life now. Amen. I'm also a product of our West Coast Urban Training Center. Amen. And it's a powerful thing. It's what basically is the college for like people like you and I. Amen. That we can be ourselves and get radical a little bit for the Lord. Amen. So don't miss out maybe after the service. And also, we want to make sure that we continue to keep the Valero family in prayer. One of our churches there at the Victory Irish Church of Salinas, the senior pastor, he got murdered while praying for an individual. Amen. He got stabbed in the neck. He bled out right there at the front of his house. Amen. That's the time that we're living in. Amen. Somebody once said that if you push an animal to the corner long enough, they're going to eventually bite. And the devil mad. Amen. Because we know that we're being an asset to the inner cities of the world. Yes. Amen. And Pastor Herb, he was a powerful man of God. He was a regional pastor. He did a lot for the community. He was a powerful man of God. Amen. He was also a part of Prayer International, and somebody just knocked at his house, asked for, you know, they're talking. As he began to pray for him, they stabbed him right in the neck. Amen. But how many of y'all know that what the enemy meant for bad, the Lord's going to use that. Amen. Even though it's a casualty, but listen, we know what we're in, what we're recruited for. Amen. We're there to reach those people. Amen. I remember when I was in Africa, we were reaching crazy people. Amen. When I was in Europe, man, we were reaching people. A matter of fact, some people were preaching, and they got slapped for preaching the gospel in Europe. And I was just like, well, sister, you know what I mean? Like, you preach, you're going to get slapped. You know what I mean? You got to expect that. Amen. But it's a powerful thing. Amen. How many of y'all know that the Lord is an awesome and faithful God? Amen. Yeah. And if you're there to the book of Isaiah, chapter 6, verse 1. And this morning, I want to talk to us about being protectors of the glory of God.
Amen.
Everyone say protectors.
Protectors.
Of the glory of God. The Bible says here in Isaiah chapter 6, verse 1. It says, in the year of King Uzziah died, I saw the Lord sitting. This is the prophet Isaiah. He said, I saw the Lord sitting on a very high throne. His long robe filled the temple. Heavenly creatures of fire stood above him. Each creature had six wings. It used two wings to cover its face, two wings to cover its feet, and two wings for flying. Each creature was calling to the other, holy, holy, holy is the Lord all-powerful or almighty.
Amen.
His glory fills the whole earth. Verse 4. Their calling caused the frame around the door to shake as the temple filled with smoke. It was the Shekinah glory. Just like what we have here when we begin to worship God, the thickness of the presence of the Lord fills the house. Amen. So this right here, this is called the Shekinah glory. Literally, it was clouded with the Lord's presence in there. Amen. I said, oh no, I will be destroyed. I am not pure. I have lived among people who are not pure. Hello, somebody. But I have seen the King, the Lord all-powerful. Verse 6. One of the heavenly creatures used a pair of thongs to take a hot coal from the altar. Then he fled to me with the hot coal in his hand. The creature touched my mouth. Everyone say, touch my mouth.
Touch my mouth.
With the hot coal and said, look, your guilt is taken away because this hot coal has touched your lips. Your sin is taken away. Let's pray. Father, we come before your presence once more. I'm praying, God, that you will use me as your instrument to communicate your word clearly and simply. I pray, my God, that every heart and every mind will be open to receive. Allow me to be relevant at this time to those in different stages of their life. Allow me, Lord God Jesus, to function under the flow of the Holy Spirit. Let me be your messenger of hope, God, a messenger, God, of your gospel, a minister of your word, God. Allow me, Lord, to demonstrate your grace, but most of all, remove all distraction. We know, Lord, that the enemy will try to use a variety of things to distract, to silence the phone, hold on to that bladder, God. Don't allow nobody move. Allow them to get your word in their hearts so they're able to use it as a weapon against the enemy. Because your word says it is better to live on the word rather than bread. And we want to be protectors of your glory, God. And we ask, God, that you have your will be performed. And we ask, Lord, for the unction and the anointing of your spirit to move here this morning. We thank you. We love you. In Jesus' name. And everyone says, amen. Amen. I want you to look at your neighbor and let them know. Be a protector of the glory of God. And then you may be seated. There's a true story about a man who once testified in one of D.L. Moody's meetings. D.L. Moody was a very powerful man of God that God used in this time to be able to bring forth the word, to set forth revival across the whole nation. Amen. Study upon him. D.L. Moody meeting. He held live. This man said on that he once lived on the mountain of transfiguration. If you don't know what the mountain of transfiguration, what it was when Jesus took his disciples and the glory of the Lord fell, and Moses and Elijah began to speak to Jesus. And Jesus, the Bible says that he was transfigured. There was a metamorphosis took place, that he was in his human body, and when the glory of God fell, he was able to transfigure into the glory of heaven. And they began to, Peter began to bow down and began to say a few things, and so a great event took place. But this man right here is a true story, and he said this statement. He said, "I've lived in a mountain of transfiguration for 5 years." D.L. Moody asked him, "How many souls did you lead to Christ last year?" Moody bluntly asked him. Well, the man hesitated. "I don't know. Have you saved any?" Moody persistently asked. "I don't know that I have," the man admitted. Well, Moody said, "We don't want that kind of mountaintop experience when a man gets up so high that he cannot reach down and save poor sinners. There's something wrong with that." And the same thing with us here in the church. There's something wrong with if you come into a house like this. This is just the building. It's an instrument that we come together to meet. Every Sunday we come, every Wednesday, every God-given opportunity that we come into the church house, we come here to tap into the presence of the Lord. Can I hear somebody say amen? Amen. We come here to exercise what's in us. We want to get so deep in the word. We want to get so deep in the clouds. If people call you holy rollers, say, "Why, bless, I'm rolling real well." Hello, somebody. There's nothing wrong with getting a hold of God. There's nothing wrong where you can go so high and never come back down. That's a good thing. I want to stay on the high, amen. I want to stay on the most high. I used to get high. I used to smoke blunts. I used to smoke tweet. And I used to puff up smokes and stay up there and come up with raps and get a little goofy and come up with all crazy ideas. But now that the Lord has changed my life, now that he has given me a purpose, some things must not change. I still am addicted to the glory of God. I'm still addicted to the presence of God. I still want more of God. I wake up in the morning longing for Jesus. I go to sleep and have to wind down and watching TV because I'm so high. Hello, somebody. See here, the man was saying that he was there for 5 years. D.L. Moody asked him then, "How many people have you led to the Lord? How many people got saved under your ministry?" Because there's something wrong when you're in the presence and the glory of God. If you're not able to minister to somebody, you're not able to tell somebody of what you just tasted, of what you just seen. It's something awkward. It's weird that when you come into the presence and the house of the Lord and things begin to take place, miracles happen, the presence of the Lord begins to fall. There's something wrong when you leave this house or leave this building and you go back home like there's nothing wrong. There's something wrong with that. See, Josiah was a very popular king. He had reigned over Israel for 52 years. He began to reign when he was just 16 years old. Come on, God's anointed now generation. There's nothing wrong with the young man ruling. He's taking his place. We got to be a church that embraces this now generation and give them the opportunity to be able to fulfill their calling, to fulfill their purpose, to find out what their destiny is. The king was, he started reigning at 16 years old. And during this period, Judah had a great military advancement and great prosperity. They developed a great water system. Then enlarged their territory by moving into the territory of the enemy, which were called the Philistines. Sometimes they were, at times they weren't able to do that in the past under other kings. They tore down the walls of Gath and Ashdod. Those were idols. The great Philistine stronghold. They planted settlements in the Philistine territory. They had every strong and powerful standing army. And he overall strengthened, everyone say strengthened, the nation mightily so that the people felt very secure and very comfortable during the reign of Uzziah. He was a popular man. Everyone say a popular man. He did mighty and great exploits for the Lord. The name of Uzziah spread across abroad throughout all the land, even it going all the way down to Egypt. Everybody heard of him. And not only that, everyone was talking about him. Everyone said they were talking about him. It began to spread, and people began to say, how mighty is this king of Israel, the king of Judah? He is a powerful man. He has done many exploits. Great things have happened through his reign. The Bible says that he was a very popular man, that even on the lips of all people, he was important and so real. But check this out. The Bible says in 2 Chronicles chapter 26, verse 5, put that down in your notes, study it in your personal time. The Bible says, as long as he sought the Lord, that God was going to make King Uzziah prosperous.
Amen.
Woo! Somebody say, I'm going to seek the Lord.
Amen.
See, when you begin to seek God, God begins to prosper you, because when you seek God, you begin to come under his lordship. You begin to come under his standard. You begin to come under on what he's ruling you to do. It's called the kingdom agenda. Everyone say the kingdom agenda.
The kingdom agenda
that God wants to spread, the good news. Good news is only good news when it comes in good timing. Amen?
Yeah.
And there's a lot of people that need to hear good news. People are tired of hearing bad news. People don't have time to be hearing about bills. People don't have time about their children rebelling. People are tired and they're weary of all bad news. We need good news, and the good news is that Jesus Christ died for our sins. We no longer have to go the direction of torment and hell. And we have a new direction. We have a purpose. God has given us life. He has given us redemption. He has given us security of our name to be written in the Lamb's book of life. Are any people been redeemed in the house here this morning? Can I hear you say amen?
Amen.
That's the good news, that God himself came from heaven. How many kings that you know that left their throne to come on the earth, to come and settle within a human body, to show us the way? For 3 years of his ministry, he preached the gospel. He preached life. He preached that we don't have to be bound by sin, bound from the enemy, bound from addiction, bound from whatever society says. He said, you come to me and I'll take care of you. As long as you stay under my reign, as long as you stay under my leadership, as long as you stay under my teaching, I will give you life everlasting. I will give you power. I will give you authority. Am I talking to anybody here this morning?
Amen.
The Bible says here in 2 Chronicles that the Lord said, Uzziah, as long as he seeks the Lord, I will make you prosperous. He was a prosperous king. He was a popular king. The kind of a man that you have great confidence in. Everyone say great confidence.
Great confidence.
And because of his accomplishments, so that the people had great confidence in Uzziah, they had come to trust in him and rely upon him perhaps too much, as so is often the case is with good people and popular leaders. At times, don't get me wrong, God sets men of God, women of God. God sets leaders to bring forth order. A leader's job is real simple. A leader is simply someone who has God-given influence to influence other people that don't want to do what God has called them to do, but that person enjoys to tell them what to do. That's what a leader is, simply. A leader just needs to make sure to put you back on track. They're able to help you. They're able to direct you. They're able to seek the Lord in your behalf when you can't seek for him. A leader has been placed, the Bible says that God places leaders before you. But the Bible says here also in Isaiah's that King Uzziah became very popular. The Bible says that everyone in their lips had the name of King Uzziah. So much so that they begin to see his accomplishments. They begin to see his prosperity. And they begin to rely upon the king rather than the creator.
My goodness.
And I'm here to let you know that there's nothing wrong with trusting your leaders. There's nothing wrong with uplifting your leaders. There's nothing wrong with praying for your leaders. But there's something wrong when you begin to place your trust, your confidence upon their life, upon them, rather than Jesus. We're not here to please man. Everyone say, I'm not a man pleaser. We're here to please God. But God has placed men there for us to take care of them. Why? Because it is the reaping and sowing principle. God puts his leaders before you so you can be able to help that leader. So when that leader begins to get lifted up, you go into their position. And one day as God begins to lift you up, that principle is going to be guided right into your life. So it's a cycle, a principle of sowing and reaping. Our trust is not in man. Our trust is not in this world. Our trust is not in our job. Our trust is not in our boss. Our trust is not in our president. Our trust is not in the system. Our trust and hope only comes from God Almighty. Somebody say amen. Our trust and our hope comes from the Lord. When you feel weary, you can trust on him. When you don't have finances and you need wisdom, the Bible says, he that needs wisdom, let them ask, because the God of wisdom will grant it to you. Woo! When your leader disappears, you appear. When your leader is not around, you get around. You lead. You guide. Because you're under the unction and the lordship of your Savior, Jesus Christ. We got to know that. Victory Outreach. Because even though right now you may settle peace, even though right now God is using the president to do all these things, well, that's good. That's okay. But the Bible says that times are getting worse. If you look at the system, if you look at what's taking place all over the world, legalized weed has become legal now here in the States. Across the world, homosexuality has taken place. They're taking God away. People are getting caught up and prospering in themselves. The church is beginning to look more like the world. We need people that are not afraid to stand up and be protectors of the glory of God. To be ones that are going to stand, obsess themselves, purify themselves, purge themselves, to keep the church house holy, to keep the church house filled with the glory of our Savior, Jesus Christ. Yeah. The Bible says that these times are going to come when it's going to be hard to show the Lord. I don't know about you, but this is a generation that's going to get hard to show the Lord. You might get favor now, but there's going to come a time when the enemy's going to be loosened to thrust his doctrine around the world. Where are all the saints at? Where are all the men of God at? Where are the women of God at? Where is God's anointed now generation at? We can't get focused. Yes, God wants us to prosper. Yes, God wants to bless us financially. Yes, God wants to bless us materialistic. But we can't get caught up in the blessings. We can't get caught up and try to make money. We can't get caught up and try to make everything all good and forget the agenda that Jesus is still trying to unfold here and now. The throne is empty. The prophet Isaiah said, the throne is empty. What are we going to do? Josiah's son is not the same as his father. There's confusion. They are in deep danger of being wiped out. Because when a king was risen to be able to overthrow whatever dynasty he had, a new king arose, they will annihilate every other family member in case they'll get bitter and try to get up on them. Hello, somebody. What are we going to do now? Isaiah is dead. The throne is empty. What are we going to do when your leader falls? What are you going to what are you going to do when a casualty happened like there in Salinas? Are we going to crumble? Are we going to be like Jesus' disciple when they strike the shepherd, the flock begin to...
Come on.
Who are you placing your trust in?
Who do you rely upon? Do you rely upon your leader so much so that when something happens, you crumble? Or are you placing your trust upon the Lord? Are you trusting the Lord in every area of your life? When finances come, when the money gets funny, which don't do, the money's getting funny, are you gonna what are you gonna do when somebody falls? What are you gonna do? Who do you place your trust in? Your pastor, the ministerial staff, your life group leader, your brother, your sister, your husband, your wife, your children? My God, the day will come when we begin to place our trust in man, when we begin to trust upon our finances. Listen, God is the creator. He is Elohim. He's the all-powerful God. He created us. He formed us. He transformed us. He's the one that gave us that job. He's the one that gave us the finances. He's the one. Your parents may have conceived you, but God conceived you. This is why we have to understand that whatever happens in life, whatever happens in the world, who you place your trust in. Okay, you're unhealthy. Okay, you might have cancer. Okay, you might have diabetes. Are you going to sit down and die? Or are you going to use the time that you have to make a difference, to impact somebody's life? Are you going to believe the report of the doctor? Are you going to believe the report of this, that, and the other? Or are you going to understand that Jesus is my creator? He's the one that loved me. And he's able to heal me, deliver me. Then so be it. In the words of Job, naked I came, naked I shall leave. But blessed is the man that trusts in the Lord. He is like a tree planted at the riverbed, that the roots reach down and get the water, the leaves blossom. Am I talking to anybody here this morning? Now, he desired the throne of God. He seen one thing, the seraphims. They are above the throne of God. The seraphims are angelic beings.
Yeah.
That's what I'm going to be focusing on here this evening. Not to put our trust in angels, but what the seraphim represented. They were above the throne of God. And he described the pharisims. Is that how I say that? Right? Seraphim. Sarah and him. All right, come on. Seraphims. Now, we are told that there were also cherubims. They're basically the same thing. Around the throne of God. These are angelic beings. And eminently, they have a great similarity between them both. Now, the Bible says in Ezekiel, he also had a vision of the throne of God in chapter 1 and in chapter 10. And he described the cherubims or the seraphims, other angelic beings that are around the throne of God. The Bible says in John chapter 4, he had a vision of the throne of God. And he saw the glassy seas in front of the throne. He saw the throne of God, and he also saw these living creatures. Everyone say living creatures.
Living creatures.
But basically, their ministry is that of just worshiping and leading the worship of God. Around his throne are the cherubims, or the creatures in Revelation that cry, "Holy, holy, holy, the Lord God Almighty, which is, which was, which is to come." The Bible says that Ezekiel identified them with the four Gospels. So you will know that Ezekiel wasn't on an acid trip. When God gives revelation or he gives insight, he doesn't does it like humanism. He gives you something that depends on the Spirit of God. Just like Joseph, when he was in jail, they needed a dream to be interpreted. And one of them said, ask Joseph, he's the one that interprets dream. And ask him, are you Joseph, the one that interprets dream? And Joseph says, I don't interpret dreams, but God does, and I can be used by him.
That's right.
So when God reveals things, they might not be humanistic, if that even is a word. The Bible says here in Ezekiel that Matthew, there was four faces on a weird creature, had long legs and feet like a calf. The Bible says that Matthew, the lion face is the chief of the wild animals, represents that he is the chief king of the world. Mark represents the ox, which at the forefront of it serving other animals, representing that Jesus was a servant of all. Luke was the man. Man is the highest among all God's creation and will one day judge angels. John is the eagle, is held of all that flies, sovereignty and being superior. We need men and women who will visibly, everyone say visibly.
Visibly.
Demonstrate the full rule of God's lordship in every area of their life. So you got to understand that. The Bible says that everybody knows God. Even the angels in hell know who God is, but yet they feared him. The Bible says that everyone knows God, but yet deny the power of. They have a form of godliness. We're living in a society, we're living in a time and age right now that even churches, preachers, those men and women that God raised to be able to lead the way, churches are becoming more like the world. Churches are no longer holding the conviction of the sovereignty of the Lord. They're no longer holding the conviction of holyism, of being holy, of being separated. Yes, this is an imperfect church. You are imperfect people, but we serve a perfect God. From the Old to the New Testament, God guides us, leads us all the way to the Father. The Ten Commandments, the first half has to do with loving God. The second half has to do with loving people. The old to the new points the way of the coming Messiah. It is a guideline. It gives us instructions. It gives us the law. Then Jesus comes in the picture, redeems our soul, slaps the enemy, gets the keys back from what he stole from Adam, and he leads us. It's saying, you are unperfect, but through my righteousness, I'm going to redeem you, and I need you to tell others what I just did for you. Amen. That's what the gospel is all about. The gospel is about the hero that dies for the villain. God loves the unperfect people, but he hates the sin that caused Adam to lose. And here, it's talking about these angelic beings that sit at the throne of God, that cover their eyes, they fly, and they cover their feet. What happened when Moses, when he was asked by the Lord to step into the presence, he said, remove your sandals because what you're standing is holy. This is why they cover the feet, because when you stand, the sole of your foot stands on holy, as signifying who the Creator is and we're the creatures. It covers the eyes that can't see the glory of God. This is why when Moses said, God, I want to see your glory. And God began to say, listen, if I appear to you, you're going to explode. Because humans, the flesh, can't be among my presence. He says, I'm going to do you a favor because you are my friend, because you listen to me. Hello, somebody, that's the key. I'm going to pass by you. And my shadow, you're going to see the glory of the Lord. Bible says that Moses, when he stepped down from the mountain, when he got the Ten Commandments, the Bible says that his face radiated by just being in the presence of the Lord. Ooh, I don't know what they said just there. And here, Ezekiel, John, and even Isaiah had a revelation. Because in order to get right with the Lord, you got to come in acknowledgement of understanding that your dependency is not upon anyone else but the Lord. That he began to look at the king because he was prosperous, but he forgot to be at the throne of the Lord to worship the master. And Ezekiel began to explain these four faces of this creature representing the gospel. He was given a clear revelation of what was coming. he was given the revelation that God Almighty, the King of all the earth, was going to come down, scoop to our level, to show us the way. He was going to be the King of Judah. He was going to be the servant of all. He was going to be the one that redeemed man. And he was going to be the one that reigned superior all over the world. Man, check this out. The Bible says, I want you to listen real carefully. I'm going to finish now. Worship team, come up. The Bible says, let me drink to this. The Bible says that Satan's very first move, softly, that Satan's very first move in the garden was to deceitfully dethrone the ruler. Scripture reference to God and relating to Adam is made as Lord God. Anytime we read in the Word of God, Lord with all caps, it refers to the name Yahweh. Everyone say Yahweh.
Yahweh
means master or absolute ruler. Used to reveal himself in his relationship with man. Prior to his name, Yahweh is God. God has revealed himself as creator, which is the word Elohim. He is the all-powerful God. He is the creator. However, when Satan spoke to Eve about eating the fruit, he did not refer to God as Lord God. Satan stripped off the name Lord, removing master and absolute ruler, and instead said, indeed has God said. In doing so, Satan kept the concept of religion while eliminating divine authority. If you study the scriptures in Genesis, Elohim means God, means the creator, all powerful. But Lord God refers to him being an absolute ruler in every area of your life. So when the enemy came and told Eve, indeed has God said, he said, has the creator said, signifying that he was referring to Eve as, he ain't your Lord if you're talking to me because you're being disobedient. So when she opened her mouth and bit, the Bible says that she came up to the man. God gave authority to the man, not to the woman. So Eve was already deceived and disobeyed God. But the whole focus of Satan wasn't the woman, it was the man. Because God gave the order to the man. Before God gave Eve to the man, God told him to what? To name the animals. That full rule. It was an image of what God wants to do here in life. He needs men of God, also women of God, don't get me wrong. But we need men of God that would take their position as priests. You don't have to have an entitlement to be a priest of God. Entitlement makes people funny. We don't need titles. We need people of conviction. People who are holy. People who are separated. This is why we have grace. Because the struggle is real. How about that? The struggle is real. Satan lusts after you. He longs for you. He wants you back because he wants at you. And the devil knew, if I can get Adam to be disobedient, then I can take lordship over the world. Check this out. The Bible says that the cherubims are protectors and carriers of the glory of the Lord. Check this out, I'm going to end with this. The Bible says in 2 Samuel chapter 6, verse 6, it says, when David's men came to the threshing floor of Nacon, the oxen stumbled,
to Zion reached out to save the ark of God. The Lord was angry with Uzziah and killed him because of what he did. So Uzziah died there beside the ark of God. David was angry because the Lord had killed him. Now the place he called the punishment of Uzziah. Verse 9. David was afraid of the Lord that day and said, "How can the ark of the Lord come to me now?" So David would not move the ark of the Lord to be with him in Jerusalem. Instead, he took it to the house of Obed-Edom, a man from Gath. Now I'm going to give you a quick summary of the scripture. The ark was stolen in 1 Samuel chapter 6 by the enemy Philistine. The glory of the Lord left from the proper place. And here in 1 Samuel chapter 6, verse 1, it says the Philistine kept the ark of God in their land 7 months. Everyone say 7 months.
7 months.
Then he called for the priests and magicians and said, "What should we do with the ark of the Lord? Tell us how to send it back home." Verse 3, the priests and the magicians answered, "If you send back the ark of God of Israel, don't send it back empty. You must give it a plentiful offering. If you are then healed, you will know that it was because the ark that you had such trouble." What happened here was, in 1 Samuel chapter 6, the enemy, the pagans, stole the ark representing the glory. And on top of the ark had these angelic beings representing, they were protectors and carriers of the glory of God. So when the enemy stole the glory and brought it back to their camp, the Bible says that they began to have a thrust of fat rats invading their territory. Then the Bible says that they had hemorrhoids and they couldn't even sit down because it was so big. The Bible says they didn't know what to do when they began to see. It's because we stole the glory from its proper place. Now we're having trouble. So they got their paganish priests and their musicians to begin to say, "Man, what should we do? Man, get healed. It's hurting." They begin to say, "Send the ark back, but don't send it empty. Send it with the offering." So when it came back, this is what 2 Samuel picks up with. David gets the ark back and starts bringing it, but they were carrying it the wrong way. They were supposed to put it on their shoulders, yet they had it rolled. So they said when it stumbled, the tire, it began to about to fall off. The Bible says that the man reached out to try to put it back up, and he got struck dead. And he got upset. "God, the glory's coming back home. This is victory. It's been long for a while." God began to say, "Listen, you were carrying it the wrong way. I gave you specific instruction. And you're not even supposed to touch it unless you're a priest." The Bible says that they left the glory at someone's house, so much so that just being in the house, that house was so blessed. So they carried it back, so much so the Bible says that David came back celebrating naked. And then his wife got jealous. She said, "Man, this is my bad, giving out there naked." The Bible says that the Lord striked her and shut her womb that she couldn't have children. Because she wasn't able to see that something powerful just happened, rather than her condemning her husband because he's so excited that the glory just came back. So what am I saying? What does this got to do with these angelic beings? I'm glad that you're asking, because I'm going to tie it all together. That was Old Testament. The Bible says about Jesus, the perfect man and the perfect God, died on the cross in our behalf. He died a death that we should have died. He lived a life that we couldn't live. The Bible says that the veil was broken. No longer did they have to carry a box on their shoulder. The glory was going to come inside us. Why? Because Jesus slapped up the devil The Bible says he was the last Adam. He did what Adam did not do. He got the keys. He got the lordship again. And he came inside of us. Literally, as we accept him, he came in us. So now we're carriers of the glory of the Lord. And the Bible says that as carriers of the word, we have to protect the word. We have to protect the glory. We have to protect the presence. The Bible says in Ecclesiastes chapter 10, verse 1, he says, a fly that landed in the ointment caused it to smell. Why? Because back in the day, the Israelites, when they would get perfume or ointments, they used to get jars. Put the oil there. Put it outside so it can dry and that smell. The Bible says that flies will come in and fall inside of the oil. And then that oil will begin to be unpurified, begin to have a stench. So they couldn't sell it. So that's the same thing as us. When we allow the world or are dependent or are weary on other things rather than what's inside you, we begin to allow things to dictate to us. And those things begin to stink up our view. They begin to stink. Am I talking to anybody here? We forget that we were created to be at the feet of the Lord, to worship, bring forth the glory of the Lord upon our lives. We allow the world to rest. With the Lord, we need men and women that understand that God is Lord God in their life, not just God. Yeah. We're so caught up in the agenda of the world, caught up in the agenda of our personal life, of our children's life. Didn't the Lord give you the children? Didn't the Lord give you that child? Didn't the Lord bless you? Didn't you rearrange you?
Jeremiah preached for all those years repentance. Ezekiel
Ezekiel says, nobody listens when I minister. And God told him, it's not about them listening to you. I need you to preach so they will know there was a prophet among you. That is your calling. What is your calling? Is your calling to suffer? Maybe. Is your calling to die for the gospel? Maybe. Is your calling to reach a certain group of people? Maybe. What is your calling? You find your calling in your relationship with the Lord. You know your purpose. I live for God. I go to God. He is my all superior. He is the Lord of my life. What is my calling? Right now, my season, my calling is to be a minister. I have my season when I help with the junior high. I have my season when I help with young adults. I have my season when I oversee the street ministry. I have my season to go to the home. I have my season to go to the UTC. I have my season to work with the K, to build the team. The Lord has raised me up. Now I'm a minister of the gospel. That is my season. That's a temporary calling for my life. And I find and I'm guided by the calling of my life through my relationship with the Lord and through my accountability. The Bible says, don't go to war without wise counsel. This is why the Lord put leaders in front of us to guide us and lead us, so they can be advisors in your life, because they relationship with the Lord. As you have a relationship with the Lord, I can tell you something. I'm gonna give a little praise report to Manny. Manny, he started dating, right? Everyone say, yay! You know who Manuel is? He is a Christian man's recovery home director. Yeah, this comes in, and we're gonna go off the car, we're gonna go eat, alright? Had a crush on this girl named Vanessa. Pastor gave him specific orders to come under me and my wife under that certain specific thing. I told Manny, you need to focus on the home. He left the church with his head down, hands up between his legs. We told the same thing with Vanessa. For how long? How long was it, Manny? How many days you counted? 7 months, right? Yo, never. Check this out. For 11 months, he kept bugging us. And I kept telling him and telling him. So much so that he even started doing what some of us do. When we hear a no from here, we go to other people to try to get a yes. And I corrected him. I said, didn't Pastor give you instructions? Don't you think that we hear from the Lord? And he left again with his head down. He's up between his legs. And we met with him. And we told him, okay, we feel like the Lord is now finally, after 11 months, 2 days, 1 minute, 29. And we told him, we want you to pray. We want you to separate for a whole week. Don't talk to her. Don't even look at her. You're in the home right now. He said, we don't want you to do that. We want you to pray. See how that is? I didn't say, oh, the Lord is speaking to me, and so he can put his trust in me. I told him, you need to pray to the Lord. Seek up for where he's going to take you. And then a week later, we're going to come together, evaluate the situation. We came back a week later. My wife took Vanessa to the other room. I took Maddie into the other room, and we talked and said, what did the Lord speak? I wrote it down in my mind. My wife came back in. Vanessa began to say, the Lord said that we're going to get married in September. The Lord said, I want to start dating. The Lord said, whatever he wants me to do, I'm going to do. And I got shocked. I was like, and my wife's like, relax, you know, I'm like, back up. You don't even know what I just heard from Manny. And Manny goes, the Lord spoke to me and said, it's time for us to date. The Lord told me that I think he wants us to get married in September. And the Lord said, if I have to be released from the home to start my marriage and be a play for another director of life, let's go. Yeah.
to talk to Vanessa? No. Then how did they get September together? Because God is Elohim. And now she is the Lord of the Lord. And it is His movement, His plan. Of the glory of the Lord. We need men and women who stop leading on their own understanding and start living a holy life. And start being guided and stop being directed. Because there's some of you that are holding us back because you ain't in your proper position. Some of you don't even know what we see. But you are so defiant that you want to lend yourself to the Lordship of Jesus. Is He Elohim in your life? Is He the absolute ruler of your life? A true man or woman of God is one who listens to the Lord. I can tell you right now, I got stains in my shirt.
Step here this morning. If that's you, if you want to accept Christ in your heart, I'm going to ask Him.